Hello, hello. Welcome to this presentation. I'm Kun Hao Ye. The topic I'm going to present today is Journey of an Addicted Kaggler, which is me, of course. Okay. For this topic, it includes three parts. For the first part, I'll show how to start the Kaggle journey. For the second part, I'll share some technical knowledge and insights learning Kaggle. For the last part, I'll try to view Kaggle from different perspectives. About me, I received my computer science master's degree from National Jiao Tong University, and my research interest was about reinforcement learning applied to computer board games. My advisor and I wrote an IEEE journal paper for the game for improved TDO methods for the game 2048. And we won first place in the 18th Computer Olympia 2048 AI competition. And currently, I'm a senior software engineer working at MediaTek about 5G modem. And in my free time, I'm a Kaggler. I won 5 golds and 6 silvers for the last 2 years, and my highest ranking was 84. And maybe someone will ask why I want to start my Kaggle journey. As you can see from my self-intro, I was doing RL-related research. However, supervised learning is much more popular in the industry. And due to my high interest in data science and machine learning, I decided to join Kaggle to sharpen up my data science and machine learning skills. And most important of all, to connect with experts from all over the world and learn from them. So, it's about 3 years ago, I decided to join Kaggle. In the first year, I need to know what I'm lack of and get myself well prepared, especially for the basic skills. So in the first year, I learned how to write Python and take online machine learning courses that use Python to program. For the second year till now, I just put myself into Kaggle competitions. But it would be a little bit too bad to just say so. So I summarize how I do this in the following parts. The first part is to start small, which means to define our own small success, like set up a local environment, learn basic Kaggle pipeline from playground competitions, and do exploratory data analysis, feature engineering modeling without referencing others' codes, and maybe keep coming up with new ideas, try to realize them and getting better public leaderboard scores. So whenever one of this is finished, I usually encourage myself that I did a great job. These are examples which I use to define my own small success. The second part is to aim high, which means to define my own greater goals. For example, to win silver, gold medals, become a Kaggle competition master, grandmaster, and get acquaintance with top data scientists and machine learning specialists from all over the world. Whenever one of this is achieved, I usually treat myself a nice meal, write down what I've done, and share my mental journey on LinkedIn. And the last part is just to keep fighting, which means to work hard, enjoy any small success, and unconsciously get addicted to Kaggle. Take myself for instance, most of the time, my crazy, simply promising idea fell. But never feel frustrated for that. You just need to know that you could still learn something, even when ideas don't work out. So enjoy any small success, get up where you fall, and you will find Kaggle is quite an addicting process. So these three parts, start small, aim high, and keep fighting, are how I start and keep Kaggling till now. To hear, most people might ask, wait, how am I supposed to Kaggle when busy, especially when our life is fully occupied by our work, family, and even sticky lovers? Take myself as an example. Whenever I'm available here, I mean any little time I could spare, like after work, in the weekend, or compiling and testing C code at work, because I'm software engineer, and waiting for the red lights to turn green when I'm working. Yeah. And back to the hotel at the night on vacation, and waiting the internet to load the TV series I follow. These are just examples that showing that we just need to squeeze any little time we have. So whenever I'm available, I do the following. I do one of the following. First, I try to understand the Kaggle problem. I ask myself how this competition is going to help solve the business problem. Is the evaluation metric reasonable? Is there any related external data sources that could help better solve this problem as well? Of course, when external data is allowed in this competition, then I'll try to generate more ideas by reading papers, Kaggle kernels, discussions, or discussing with teammates, or trying to interpret experimental results. Then I'll list my ideas, prioritize them, and do experiments. Once experiments are done, I'll try to ask myself whether the results are as expected. If not, I'll further review where I did something wrong. From my experiences, with something that seems to work intuitively, or someone says something works, but the idea failed when we are implementing it, there must be something wrong in our program. So don't give up too fast. We just need to review what we've done. So the last page was just my personal experiences. You don't have to follow it, but develop your own ways of making use of your trivial free time. In short, we have to be aggressive. We have to binge tackling, and being busy is not an excuse if we really want to learn or achieve something. And there is one more idea I want to share with you. That is, we don't have to achieve our goals in a short time, but just keep learning and enjoy the process, and you will reach your goals one day. Being busy might take us longer to achieve our great goals, like becoming a Kaggle master, grandmaster, but we'll reach those goals as long as we keep improving ourselves day by day. And it's much better than doing nothing at all. For the first part of today's topic, I share my mental journey about why and how I joined Kaggle and keep Kaggle until now, and hope that gives you some guide if you haven't officially joined Kaggle yet. For the second part of the topic, I'm going to share technical knowledge and insights learning Kaggle, including my Kaggle pipeline, some important notes for Kaggling, and my experiences about connection with great minds. It is for your reference for how I actually do Kaggle. And this is my Kaggle pipeline. The first step is to do exploratory data analysis. For those who want to become a Kaggle kernel master and grandmaster, I highly recommend to develop your own ways of exploring the data and do data visualization for people on Kaggle to quickly understand the data before looking into other kernels. For those who have little time and end to compete only, like me, I would suggest don't spend too much time in the first step, but just to have a quick overview of how the data looks like and how to do basic cleaning and formatting to build the baseline model. So after building the baseline model, I will do more feature engineering, feature selection, or tuning the architecture of neural network. And remember to stick to the same cross-validation methods, both splitting, and set the out-of-focus predictions for model assembly in the later stages. And after improved models are built, I will try more features I thought of, or possibly better neural network architecture. Oh, I will do the error analysis. try to figure out where my models don't perform well using out-of-order predictions. Or I would do EDA again to get more sense about how to make more powerful features. And now, it is also possible to do EDA with out-of-order predictions to see where models perform not so well under what distribution of data and get some insights to create more features. Well, the part in red rectangle, the pipeline differs from model to model. Like GPU and neural network might use very different data preprocessing methods. For example, only to normalize the data and deal with missing values while large GPU don't. And different model improving methods. For example, neural network could be improved a lot by using very different architecture to create different levels of feature interaction within neural networks. But for large GPU, we often need to handcraft more features to help the model capture more data properties. So for the part in red rectangle, the pipeline differs from model to model. And here's the pipeline I use to check whether my models works fine. The green rectangle corresponds to the red rectangle in this page. Every once while I make a submission to check my public leaderboard scores, if the leaderboard score improves roughly proportionally to the cross-validation score, I would think the model is fine to test that as well. If not, I will review my features and validation strategies. Here are a few questions I often ask myself. Do we use time-based bleed for temporal data if the test data is in the future compared to the trend data? What is the size of validation and test data? Should we trust validation score more or test score more, since there could be much more score variation in smaller data? And how's our validation scores variation between codes? Do we need to do backing? And is there any leaky features, like we use the wrong methods to do target encoding? And is there any feature that fits to noise easily? Or other reasonable validation schemes we could try as well in order to make our cross-validation score reflect how leaderboard scores improves? And how's the difference between trend and test set? Maybe trend and test differs a lot, so locally cross-validating improvements are naturally difficult to translate to leaderboard score improvements. And there could be more questions we need to ask ourselves. So I summarize the ideas in this page. The first part is to find a good way to do cross-validation. I'll call it CV from now. The second part is to select features. Well, the first part, there are many cross-validation methods like most common K-fold, stratified K-fold for multi-class, multi-level problems, time-split K-fold for if our task is to predict features, and adversarial K-fold if trend and test set differ too much. And there could be even combined of them. But the idea here is to simulate the trend test different to make locally cross-validation scores reflect how the testing scores might improve. So most of the time, we could trust our CV scores, but we still need to check once in a while whether the testing score is fine as well. Furthermore, submitting our test set prediction not too often could prevent us from overfitting to public test set as well, because we won't use too much public score information to select our models. For the second part is to select features. We need to identify noise features to reduce chances of overfitting. There are some ways like shuffling one feature at a time and see if CV scores decreases or not. If the city score doesn't change or even increases, the feature is not important and even noisy. Because shuffling the feature increases, if shuffling the feature makes CV scores increases, it might mean that the feature might be very misleading to the model. And here I'm gonna share my experiences about connection with great minds. Because Anova was a former Kaggle breakfast was actually my teacher on the Zora course, and he became a mentor as well as a great friend to me. We team up and want to go together, and I'm also honored to get recommendation from him on LinkedIn. And there are many machine learning specialists to network with, learn from them, and win gold silver together. Sometimes we exchange codes to check each other's ideas, and I feel it amazing to have an expert to review my code and idea for free. Okay, for the last talk in this presentation, I'll try to view Kaggle from different perspectives, which include Kaggle versus real-life projects, and some arguments about Kaggle I see mostly on LinkedIn. In this page, I'm going to share my viewpoints about how Kaggle project similar to real-life projects. In real-life project, we have collected data and application data, maybe from users. In Kaggle, we are given train set with labels and test set without labels. We could submit our test predictions, but only the public testing part will be evaluated. The private test part scores will be revealed when competition ends. And the private test set is like application data. Both are where we want our machine learning models to ultimately perform well. In Kaggle, the public testset should be close to the private testset, so that Kagglers optimize the leaderboard scores and the score is what competition host wants. But public and private testset are still different sets to avoid Kagglers overfitting to the public testset. Yes. And here by close means similar data distribution, closing timing, or similarity in other attributes that condition holds consider indicative to their applications. In real life projects, we might want to select our test set close to the application data as much as possible, so that test set performance is indicative of what our model will perform on application data. So these two relations should be similar somehow. And for both real life and Kaggle projects, we want to develop our CV strategies that can reflect testset's improvements and try to improve our CV score most of the time without probing the testset too much and getting overfitted to the testset. In this page, I'm going to share my viewpoints about how Kaggle project different from real life project. First, on Kaggle, we don't need to format a business problem into a machine learning problem by ourselves, but we still can learn how other competition hosts do it. And mostly, we don't need to do much data cleaning and engineering or get worried about data sources. And lastly, we don't need to consider how to deploy the machine learning models, like the trade-off between efficiency and accuracy or other metrics. And here, I'm going to share some arguments about Kaggle I see on LinkedIn. The first one is, a real data scientist needs a lot of other skills like data science problem defining, data cleaning, engineering, leadership, communication, teamwork. However, Kaggle is far limited to learn those skills. For data science problem defining, we could still learn how other conditions was doing on Kaggle. For data cleaning, engineering, we did seldom need to do those on Kaggle. For leadership, communication, teamwork, we could still learn to team up with others. The next one is, Kagglers put too much effort for tiny improvements, which is impractical and a waste of time and resources. I think it depends on the problem. A 0.1% improvement might translate to huge benefits in industry, considering how large the base we are talking here. And we could be the ones who are able to push machine learning models to their limits, but choose not to do so in real-life projects, considering the resources available. And it is different from who are not able to do so at all. And Kaggle is a perfect place to learn how to push machine learning models to their greater limits. Okay, that's another list. The first one is do not Kaggle all the time. Spend time with family, friends, lovers. Don't be too addicted to Kaggle and ignore people who are important to us. And spend some time exercising because we need a healthy body to Kaggle more. And wish you all enjoy Kaggling, feel fruitful on the way learning, and reach your own goals. Thank you. So it is now Q&A session, right? Any questions you'd like to ask? Both in English or in Chinese, it's okay. It's okay.
So if you've got any question, you just put up your hand and our volunteer will pass a microphone.
Can I speak in Chinese? 第一个问题是，作为数据科学家有没有受到年龄限制，比如像程序员一样？不好意思，我有点听不太清楚。就是说，作为数据科学家，会不会像程序员一样，会受年龄限制？比如说，过了30岁以后就不好工作了，怎么样？说受影响。是。OK，I can speak English. As a data scientist, is there any age limitation like programmers? Is there any age limitation?
Age limitations.
年龄限制。我在这里，因为那个我们的工号是来自台湾，所以他可能对这个大陆的情况不是很了解。不好意思。是这样，因为就因为在大陆会有一个说法，是程序员过了30个岁以后，可能就会有一个下坡路。如果你又没有做过做到中层或者是领导层的话，可能你的后面的路就不太好走。然后我们这位同学就是想问一下，
在做程序员这点，或者在做数据科学家这件事情上，有没有这样一个年龄限制？对。Should I answer in English or Chinese?
As you wish, we got simultaneous translation.
我觉得，因为我还没30岁，所以这个问题其实有点困难。我觉得。 在 data science 这方面的领域比较像是业余的爱好者，所以我不觉得它有什么年龄的限制。就是对我来说，就是不断的探索资料，然后建一些很有用的 model， 这对我来说是很有趣的一件事情。所以作为一个业余爱好者，我不觉得这有什么年龄限制。但是因为我本身职业是 software engineer， 所以但是可能相对起来压力会比较大一点，所以。 我觉得相较起来 ，software engineer 还是比较有 edge 的 limitation。好，谢谢。
你好，我想问一下，就是有些软件工程里面的一些这个技巧，能不能用在咱们的数据挖掘这些里面？就是有没有一些软件工程的他们一些什么怎么工作的流程啊，然后有些技巧能对这个数据科学也比较有帮助的。
不好意思，可以帮我切回投影片吗？我觉得其实最有帮助的部分就是 prioritize ideas 这个部分，因为我身为一个 software engineer， 其实被 assign 的 job 还算蛮杂蛮多的，所以时间上基本上是蛮紧的，然后在工作上也是。在工作上比较像说，你要怎么去分清楚哪些优先顺序，哪些该先做，然后这样才让你整体工作看起来是有效率、有成效的。然后在 Kaggle 也是，因为我在弄 Kaggle 的时候，基本上都是下班，就是周末一些比较零碎的时间，所以我没有办法把所有的 ideas 全部都一试过，所以我还是要学会去分辨说怎么去优先。去 prioritize 哪些事情应该是先去尝试或先去做的，这是我发现一个就身为一个 software engineer 和 Kaggle 的一个共同的点。谢谢。
Thank you。
我的问题是在这个做 competition 的时候，这个 team 里面是怎么分工的？大家，谢谢。
其实一开始不会一下就组成一个 team， 因为其实大家都会怕说有人组队之后，有些队员小伙伴们会变成 idol 不做事情，所以基本上都是大家先爬到一定的 ranking 之后，才会开始组队。那这时候组队太早组队，一个缺点就是，大家的 ideas 可能会 converge 到某一个点，所以这样子对于做 model assembling 或是 build 一个更 general 的 model 其实是有伤害的，所以通常是大家会先自己研究资料，自己理到一定程度之后才来组队。那组队之后里面。工作分布比较小，一开始组队的时候会，大家会 share 自己的 idea， 然后就其实，在 share 过程中就会发现，大家去 interpret 一样的资料，或者是 view model 方式其实不太一样，或是做验证的方式不太一样，所以刚开始组队的时候比较像是说，去就 cross validation 而言，就是去 view， 先建立一个 common 的。共同的那个 validation 的方式，因为最后大家很怕都要做 example。然后第二个点就是去看说哪些 feature 不一样，然后有些人可能是试着把其他队友的 feature 特征整合起来，去看说 model 会不会在进步。然后所以组队后的分工就会变成说，一开始是整合大家的意见，或整合大家不同做验证方式，然后之后才会。各自做，就是最后还会大家会看说谁有哪些不一样还没做完的 ideas， 然后看也是像这样去 prioritize 他们，然后去分说，可能 A 这个队员先做 idea A，B 这个队员做 idea B， 然后就变成同时多线进行，对，谢谢。
这个你好，我想问一下，就是您对您现在作为一个 Kaggle 的一个爱好者，您是希望 Kaggle 作为一个副业去赢取一些奖金，还是说希望您以后的职业从软件工程师变成数据科学家？然后那个希望没有冒犯您。
啊，没有，我也没有，别介意。其实我一开始有想过，就是程序员不能 年纪也是不能太大问题，而且我对 machine learning 方面是比较有兴趣的，所以一开始我的确是想要借由 Kaggle 去充实自己，然后从 software engineer 转成 data scientist 或 machine learning engineer 之类的。然后后来发现，因为我现在是在做5G 相关的开发，然后刚好公司有一些跟 AI 相关的 project， 所以刚好我运气还不错，就是 Kaggle 上学到一些东西，有办法带到工作上。对，所以就之前会想要转职，然后现在就可能是 software engineer， 但是又同时可以把 Kaggle 上学到一些知识 apply 到工作上这样。谢谢。
数据有关的行业，职位比较多，比如数据分析师、数据工程师，还有数据科学家。就您个人理解，觉得数据科学家跟数据工程师还有数据分析师他们之间的共性和差异是什么呢？
我只能分享说，我在 LinkedIn 看到上的一些 insight， 就是用。我本身没有实际上去应征那些职位，只有稍微在 LinkedIn 上看过。就我的理解 ，data scientist 的要求可能会比较全面性一点，就是从 data analysis、data engineering 到 build predictive model， 其实都可能蛮要求的。我是看人家 job description， 因为我实际上没有应征，我也会不确定。然后可能 data engineer 或 data analysis 或 machine learning engineer 可能就是比较specific 一点，像 machine learning engineer 可能就是有 data engineer 帮他处理好资料，然后 machine learning engineer 可能就比较偏向去 build 很强或是可以 apply 的 model。我这边说 apply 的 model， 可能说，因为实际上有些 deep learning 的 model 不一定是可以 apply 到所有产品的上，所以还要考虑一些实际上的考量的。
OK， 谢谢。
谢谢。
你好，就我想问一下，您认为什么样才是一个好的模型，好的那个分析的结果？就因为我只是一个初学者，有时候我就做到可能那个评分 F score 达到0.7，差不多我就觉得可能我不能再做下去了，再继续往下做可能会过拟合，因为我只拿到一部分的样本，我不知道评级是怎么样的。就不知道应该怎么往下继续，然后我也没参加过竞赛的那些。谢谢。
哎，不好意思，我想补充问一下，你是想问
就
实际上的 project 还是说在 Kaggle 上？
啊，您都说一下吧，可以吗？
实际上的话，可能就是看你 boss 的要求，因为可能长官在意的不是你，就是。可能 model improve 一点，可能对做到某个程度就已经几乎是极限了。但是，可能做到再更好一点，那如果长官还是不能符合你 boss 的 requirements 的话，那就真的做不下去了。那如果是在 Kaggle 上，可能就比较不用担心这个问题，因为你有 submit 的话，你就知道你 public testing score 的结果，所以你就会知道说，哎，别人是可以做多好，你就会去想要去。想尽办法去追上他们。一开始我也是这样，因为我一开始很难知道说，我对他的 analysis 或做要做多少，然后去做多少 powerful 的 feature， 这样才叫 bot， 然后才能 build model， 然后怎样 model 才叫 bot， 然后其实都是看别人比较的。然后对，谢谢。
啊，好，谢谢。
哎，聂夫老师，那个我想咨询一下，您 就在做 Kaggle 的赛题的时候，有没有偏向于一类或者是模型类？就是说，因为毕竟 Kaggle 上的赛题，像时序类的题，或者是就是纯数据挖掘类的，或者是图形图像识别的这些，像您是这个软件工程这个专业嘛，但是也做这个是属于爱好嘛，然后有没有说是偏向于某一类，或者说是来者通吃这种情况。然后另外呢，就对于你像我们这些初学者来说的话，是来者不拒为好呢，还是偏向于选自己擅长的或者喜好的一部分？精彩想法，谢谢。
谢谢。就我个人而言，一开始其实是从 tabular data 去入手，就是因为 tabular data 就比较容易，就是就视觉化或是 apply model 而言，其实是比较容易的。可以看到 Kaggle 上其实很多人就是 tabular data 基本上都是用 LogicAI 当做一个很强的 baseline model， 所以一开始初学者我会建议用先从 tabular data 开始下手，然后就我个人经验，我一开始也是从无到有开始参加 Kaggle。那我一开始也是参加就是选 tabular data 的，然后同时我去上一些 deep learning 的课程，所以当时候也去了解一些不同的问题，就像 LP 或是影像处理之类的，然后去 apply 那种 deep learning 的 model， 所以后来才会慢慢去接触Time series 的问题，或是 LP 相关的，或者 是影像相关的这样，对，就是就一步一步来。然后，如果当你都可以 handle 的话，我就会建议说，你还是选你喜欢的比较好，因为你也是要做你有兴趣的，才会想要把 machine learning model build 得更好，才会更有成就感。
提到你是一位全职的软件工程师，然后我想问一下，你怎么在日常工作中做到工作跟这个 Kaggle 比赛相平衡的？因为就是据我所知， Kaggle 比赛一般的持续周期可能大概有至少要有几个星期，然后你一般平均参加一场 Kaggle 比赛大概要花多长时间？然后你怎么平衡工作所花的时间和比赛的时间？我想问一下。
我举我最近之前刚比完的一个比赛，叫做 Chip Show Unintended Bias in Toxicity Classification 的比赛。然后花多少时间这个问题，我平均下班就会花至少三个小时，然后周末可能就是两天几乎都是八个小时，所以一个礼拜都大概花三十一个小时。然后这个比赛是我从一开始就参加了，所以就是三十一乘十二个小时的一个比赛，平均下来大概是这样。然后就是过程中就是不断的去 try 各种 model 啊，或者是用不同的方法去 improve model。然后另一个问题是怎么在工作和比赛中做到平衡？其实我要回到我刚才那个点，就是真的是需要蛮有效率的，因为工作上并不是所有事情都是那么急迫，或者是必须立刻完成，而是需要有效率的先挑重要事情完成。然后 Kaggle 也是一样。所以我刚才有举一个例子，就是说有时候因为我是 software engineer， 然后我们有时候写完 code 要去 build， 然后或者是要把 code 放去跑比较长时间的测试的时候，我这时候就会 switch 到去看一下说，哎，我 我现在的 Kaggle Project 做到什么程度，我的实验结果，或者说我还有什么方法可以去 improve 我的 model， 就是不断在切换的过程。然后下班就是基本上都是投入在 Kaggle 上，还有周末也是，几乎都是。
好，
好，谢谢。
你好，就我个人而言，我是先对数据感兴趣，先接触 Kaggle， 然后我才知道说，需要有一些编程的能力，然后我才开始学 Python。然后我想问的问题是说，在做数据分析或者在 Kaggle 上打比赛的时候，除了我们常用的 Python， 那还是否需要去学习其他的计算机语言和编程的能力？
其实我在比 Kaggle 都只有用到 Python， 所以我觉得应该 Python 来比 Kaggle 概念应该算是蛮足够的，因为它其实包含多 library 可以 package 可以用，但是有一些 software engineer 相关的东西还是可以学，因为有时候因为在用 Python 做 feature 的时候，如果一些比较基本的演算法或者是算法没有效率的话，你在生 feature 的时候会比别人久很多，尤其当资料量很大的时候。对，所以有些是不限于说是一定要是用 Python 或是用 C， 而是所有程式语言都有一些 common 的演算法或逻辑，那就可能需要加强一下，会对，
比如说补充什么呢？补充学习哪一方面？
像是有时候要算 feature 的时候，你要往回捞一些资料来算，那你怎么捞？如果你有时候全部都用预设的 API， 可能不会很快，或是用预设的 API 去捞，然后那些 API 背后其实做一些 redundant 的事情，然后当资料量很大的时候，你其实有时候那个 feature 会 generate 会卷不完，对，所以有时候反而是要靠自己去改写 API， 或者是知道那个 API 背后在做什么，然后把它写成另外一个符合你现在目标的 API。对，对。
好，谢
我想问一下，就是如果有时候训练模型，比如说深度学习，如果训练有很久，请问你训练是在自己的电脑，还是有什么平台可以训练？
我其实一开始在自己电脑的确训练很久，然后我后来就一直架构任何的周边设备，就是更好 CPU 啊，然后自己买 GPU 或者是更大的 RAM， 然后当我自己电脑还撑不住，我就是会用 GCP， 就 Google Cloud 的推控去算。然后最近 Kaggle 其实也有 GPU 资源，所以可以的话也是可以先用 Kaggle， 这样就不用花你自己的电这样。
好，谢谢。
您好，我想问一下，就是在你自己在比赛前大概把就是成绩做到一个什么水准？就是比赛前一般我们是做，就是组队前一般是比赛结束前一两周左右，然后你那个时候在组队前自己大概是做到一个什么水准？就是自己只完成了一个单模型，还是说把很多模型去 assemble 之后获得一个比较好的成绩，然后再去和别人组队？因为我们组队的话，你肯定要有一个比较好的成绩，别人才愿意和你组队。所以你是一个单模型，还是说 ensemble 获得一个比较好的成绩之后再和别人组队？谢谢。
通常一开始会比较偏向是单模型。对，然后像我这些比赛的经验，可能我会因为想要增加队伍的 diversity， 然后我一开始因为有些常合作的伙伴，然后所以我一开始可能会偏好做一些别人比较不会做的事情，像是一开始有些 time series 问题，有些人会用 那个 TS Spread， 或者用一些 Feature Engineering 的方法，或 Sliding， 用 Sliding Window 去算那些 Feature， 然后 apply 到 Light GPU， 然后我可能就直接就是用 Deep Learning 的 Model。那这样跟别人组队的时候，其实跟别人组队的时候，一个是要么就是成绩要够好，当然不仅限于单 Model 或者是 Example 后结果，就是第一个是成绩要够好，然后第二个点是说你的 idea 要跟别人没有重复，因为其实组队发要求的时候，其实要稍微 share 一下说，哎，你大概是用什么方式或用什么 idea， 那这样子队伍组起来才会有 game。啊，如果你看对方做的很像，那如果分数又两个都很好，那也许组下来其实帮助并不会太大。谢谢。
我们感谢大家的提问，然后也非常感谢 Michael。下面是我们的茶歇环节，然后茶歇。